Well, I am very excited to be back here with you all. I love it any time I get to be here. And I got to tell you, I've missed you guys. You know, I was gone a few. I really have. And part of the reason I missed you is because last time I was here, it was snowing in April. And everybody assured me, they said, "Hey, Dave, do not worry. When are you coming back?" I said, "I'm coming back in the middle of May." They said, "Oh, 70s. May is the sweetest time. Oh, you're going to love it in Chicago in May. I mean, you will love it. Get ready, you know, bring your suntan lotion, be all set." So I came and it was in the 40s and kind of rainy, but you know what? I'm not here for the weather. I'm here for the people, okay? So that's why I'm here. And I'm excited to be back at Harvest. Late last year, our family realized that it had been a long time since we had all gotten together. And so we did some planning. We didn't think we could pull this off, but somehow we said, let's have an early Thanksgiving celebration in Phoenix. I was going to be in Phoenix. And so our entire immediate family somehow was able to make flights and to get there and to give up some vacation time. And for the first time in several years, we all were together, and it was just awesome. But with Christmas right around the corner, we decided, hey, let's get together and let's take a picture that we can use for our Christmas card the next month. And so we called up a guy, and he said, meet us somewhere, and we met him at this place, and showed up, and we all got to know him for a second. He said, "Okay, I've picked a spot, so walk with me." And we went to this predetermined location that he had, and he started putting us in position. You know what that's like, you know, okay, you know, don't really enjoy it, and will the grandkids behave? And got us all in the right spots, and then he started taking pictures, and then he looked at his camera, and he said, "Okay," he said, "these are good, but," he said, I need bigger smiles." He said, "Okay, so everybody," and we thought he was going to say cheese, but that's not what he said. Instead, he said, "Okay, somebody's pregnant." Okay, well, it was kind of weird, and we kind of all smiled, and that was a family picture, and he kept clicking away, and then all of a sudden, he said it again. He said, "Somebody's pregnant." But when he said, "somebody's pregnant," the second time, my younger daughter said, "and it's me." And we went crazy, all right? I mean, we were so jubilant. We threw our hands up. We celebrated. What an incredible memory we'll have for the rest of our lives. But I want you to notice something here. You need to notice the compliant little guy there. That's Bauer, okay? And Bauer didn't turn his head. He had the focus of an air traffic controller, right? And we're like, wow, we must have put the fear of the Lord in this kid, okay? Everybody's celebrating with him. I think it's starting to sink in that he is no longer going to be the baby of the family, is what it is. But there's genuine excitement when someone shares the news, "I'm going to be a mother," that God is going to bless him with a child. And today we're going to learn about a mother who must have cringed when she heard that she was pregnant. You say, why would anybody cringe when they heard that? Well, her story begins at a time when babies were being slaughtered because of the whim of the Egyptian Pharaoh. And you have to understand that it was not a good time to be an Israelite. They had been slaves for many, many years, but because the Israelites had grown in number, Pharaoh had made their work even harder, and he had also issued a decree that's unimaginable to us. Pharaoh had decreed that all male Israelite children were to be killed at birth, and the soldiers were commanded to throw them into the Nile River. And so this baby, who you know to be Moses, will be born into a very hostile and pagan culture full of false gods. And Moses is a primary figure of the Old Testament, and he's spoken of frequently in the New Testament. We know an awful lot about Moses, but we don't know so much about his mom. In fact, on your note page, Moses is mentioned in the Bible over 800 times, while Jochebed is mentioned only twice. Jochebed, Jochebed, is mentioned only two times, and Jochebed is Moses' mom. And we don't know a whole lot about her, But here's what we do know. Jochebed left behind an incredible legacy as a mother. And like many moms, she just doesn't get a lot of recognition. She just doesn't get a whole lot of notice. She just goes about her work quietly behind the scenes. But to a great extent, a mother's legacy is defined by her children. And Jochebed had three children that we know of, and they were each used by God in significant ways. And so we see Jochebed has these three children that we know of, and each one of them has a powerful role to play in God's plan for his people. So this weekend, we want to look at the important qualities that matter and appreciate these unsung heroes that are in our midst at each and every campus. And whether you are a mom or whether you are praying that someday God would enable you to be able to have a child, I hope that these qualities will become a goal for you. And for the rest of us, I pray that we will just lean in and hopefully we'll walk away with greater appreciation for moms and all it is that they do. So let's look at this life of Jochebed together. If you want, you can turn in your Bibles to Exodus chapter 2, and we're going to discover three significant qualities that we see in her life. The first one is this. It's that of being a positive encourager. That's the first quality, a positive encourager. That's one of the roles that you bring to the table, Mom. How can you encourage? How can you breathe life into the family? Exodus chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. Now a man from the house of Levi went and took as his wife a Levite woman. The woman conceived and bore a son, and when she saw that he was a fine child, she hid him for 3 months. So it says here in Exodus 2 that Jochebed saw that her son was a fine child. She saw something in him that was beyond normal and she valued it. Jochebed is a loving mother who just knows that her child is the most beautiful child in all the world, is the most special child in all the world. Now, not every mom can be right when they say that, but in some ways, every mom should feel that way about their newborn. And in their eyes, their child really is the most beautiful and the most special in their mind. And so we realize that one of the ways that a mom leaves a legacy is by vocalizing that to her kids, by being that positive encourager to her children. Our children need to know, they need to hear it out loud. They need to see us, that we value them and that we see them as being important. Whether you're at a recital, whether you are at a ball game, your child can pick your voice out of a crowd like a piano tuner can hear a wrong note or a right note. That's how skilled they become at listening for your voice as a parent or as a grandparent. You know, at Harvest, the campus pastors are always encouraging husbands and fathers to reject what can sometimes be a tendency of men towards that of passivity. And the challenge is to reject passivity, to spiritually lead your homes. And guys, that's your responsibility. Harvest has a men's event coming up in just a few weeks, and it's called Act Like Men. And this is a great opportunity for you guys to say, okay, I'm going to go, I'm going to spend a weekend together. I promise you it will be a time of strengthening. It will be a time of encouraging you. And if you haven't signed up for that, go online today and say, you know what, I'm going to invest a couple of days. I'm going to be a part of that special weekend. And just as men need to reject a tendency toward passivity and they need to be the spiritual leader within the home, the challenge for mothers and for wives is to reject a spirit of negativity or of criticism. Even in the midst of all of the pressures and responsibilities, to say, I am going to be a person who is positive and who is a joyful encourager within my own home. And that's not always easy, especially when day in and day out you go through all sorts of challenges and tough times and responsibilities. But the Bible tells us in 1 Thessalonians, in the 5th chapter and the 11th verse, I love what it says here. It says, therefore, encourage one another and build one another up just as you are doing. And moms, that is a really significant role for you. for every mom to just take years and just build into a son, to build into that daughter. Solomon says in Proverbs chapter 18, verse 21, says, death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruits. So the tongue has the power of life and death. Now, my mom was the greatest Christian example that I ever met. And so I know that that's rare, that I was blessed with that, and I don't take that for granted. But my mom was also very overprotective. And so every toy that I picked up as a kid, she was convinced that toy was going to poke my eye out, right? You know? Now, I can understand with a Red Ryder BB gun or something like that, or a bow and arrow set, something like that. But, I mean, any toy I picked up, my mom was like, hey, Dave, no. Don't play with that. Why? That thing will poke your eye out. Mom, it's a beach ball, okay? I feel very safe with this. My mom would say strange things to me. She'd say, hey, Dave, eat your spinach. Eat your spinach. Hey, if you eat your spinach, you can grow up and look just like Popeye. That's the dream of every American male, right? I'd love to look like Popeye. Then I could get a girl who looks like olive oil, right? But moms say strange things, especially when they get upset with us. My mom, no lie, my mom would say this. She'd say, stop tattling on your brother. Stop tattling on your brother. If you don't stop tattling, I'm going to tell your father. It didn't quite make sense. Or she'd be at the dinner table and I would be talking too much, which was quite often, and she would say a phrase that never made sense to me. She'd say, shut your mouth and eat your food. Well, how are you going to pull that one off, you know? Shut your mouth and eat your food. My favorite one would be when she would want me to go out and mow the lawn, and I'd say, oh, I'm watching this TV show. I think Gilligan's going to get off the island. You know, some of you know who Gilligan is. Others of you don't. But, you know, I really don't want to leave. Oh, you've got to go mow the lawn. So finally, I'd get up to go out and mow the lawn, and I would be barefoot. And she said, where do you think you're going, Mr. Smart Guy? I said, well, you wanted me to mow the lawn. I'm going out to mow the lawn. You are not going out there and mowing that lawn barefoot. So why not? And then this is where she said something that, because she was upset, it didn't make a lot of sense. She said, if you go out there and you mow that lawn barefoot, that lawnmower will cut your legs off. Right? Now, granted, it could do a lot of damage, but I mean, come on, it can't cut your legs off. Mom, there's no way that, okay, all right, Mr. Smart Guy, go on out there, mow the lawn barefoot. But when that lawnmower cuts your legs off, don't come running to me. I don't understand that, right? All of those statements that she made were always motivated out of love and concern for my well-being. Statements like, your dad and I love you very much. Or the scriptures that she would strategically place around the house. Do unto others as you would have others do unto you. Or be kind and compassionate to one another. Or the one that she had on my bathroom wall. So I saw it every time I brushed my teeth, and that is a soft answer turns away wrath, because she knew how brothers like to argue and fight. And some of you know how true this is, that words can breathe life into you like that. And too many of you, sadly, know what it's like to have pain and negativity breathed into you and spoken to you. You're not as pretty as your sister. I wish that we had never had you. Not only does Jochebed adore Moses because he's her boy, but she sees incredible potential in him. Even in the New Testament, Moses' parents are actually celebrated because they saw that there was something unique about him. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 23 says, by faith, Moses' parents hid him for 3 months after he was born because they saw he was no ordinary child. And they were not afraid of the king's edict. So there was something that was distinctive that they could tell about this child, and they could tell that God was up to something, and that Moses was meant for something. And as parents, we can see those things in our kids, but it's one thing to know that God has something amazing in store for our children. It's another thing to tell them and to express it and to lovingly help them achieve it. And Jochebed saw something in Moses. And she didn't keep it to herself. One of my earliest recollections from my childhood would be when my mom would pray with me at night, and she would come in the room, she'd tuck me in bed when I was a little kid, and then she would say, I'm going to pray with you before you go to sleep. And she would pray with me. And there was a phrase that my dad and my mom would both say when they prayed for me. And here's what they would say. At some point in the prayer, they would say, oh God, I can't wait to see how you're going to use Dave for your glory. And so as a little child, I didn't fall asleep wondering if God could use me. Instead, I fell asleep wondering how he might use me. And that only happens if you have a parent who is a positive encourager. Well, here's the second characteristic that we see in Jochebed's life, and that is that she was an intentional discipler. She's an intentional discipler. This is a very courageous act from a mother raising a child in this violent world. She attempts to keep and to hide her son, because not only would Moses have been killed if she were caught, but her whole family would have been killed for this offense, including Jochebed. But she fearlessly hides Moses. They had probably been studying Pharaoh's daughter's schedule and bathing habits, because Jochebed will evidently pull her daughter Miriam in on this plan, and it will test her acting skills. Look back in your Bible at Exodus chapter 2, verses 5 through 8. Then Pharaoh's daughter went down to the Nile to bathe, and her attendants were walking along the riverbank. She saw the basket among the reeds and sent her female slave to get it. She opened it, and she saw the baby. He was crying. She felt sorry for him. This is one of the Hebrew babies, she said. Then his sister, look at this, Miriam just pops up out of the blue. Then his sister asked Pharaoh's daughter, hey, shall I go and get one of the Hebrew women to nurse the baby for you? Yes, go, she answered. So the girl went and got the baby's mother. She went and got Jochebed because she knew that she could nurse him. Do you see how God works all of this out? Do you see God working upstream, literally? It's this incredible story of God protecting Moses. So Jochebed is essentially paid by Pharaoh's daughter to take care of Moses, her own child. But at some point, Jochebed has to trust God with the future of her child at an early age. But Moses, as we know, grew up having a sense of who he was. That would not have been easy growing up in Pharaoh's household. But through his interaction with his birth mom and siblings early in life, he grew up worshiping God and following the one true God. And in this immoral culture that was full of idols, he understood who the one true God was. Look back in your Bible at verses 9 and 10. And Pharaoh's daughter said to her, take this child away and nurse him for me, and I will give you your wages. So the woman took the child and nursed him. And when the child grew older, she brought him to Pharaoh's daughter, and he became her son. She named him Moses because, she said, I drew him out of the water. None of this happened by accident. I think that Jochebed must have been intentional and purposeful with whatever time she had in those early years, trying to instill within this child the word of God and who he was, that he was a child of God. She didn't know how much time she would have. She didn't know when that knock might come to her door, or when Pharaoh's daughter might say, no, we don't need your services any longer. This is my child. And so she has to have a sense of urgency. And I want you to know you have to have that sense of urgency too. You know, when it comes to parenting, always keep the end in mind. We are raising them to release them. You are trying to prepare them for adulthood, but it takes a lot of work. Moms, you constantly are going the extra mile. You're getting to know your kids well. You're discovering their strengths and their weaknesses. You're trying to get involved in their world. You're trying to understand who it is that they are. That means that you're trying to learn technology so that you can just keep up with them. Technology is a struggle for, I'd say, anybody over the age of 40 or 45. I mean, I'm constantly calling my adult children and saying, hey, I just need some help. What do you need help with? How do I turn my iPhone on? It's the simpler things. It's like, just help me with this, okay? Maybe you saw the text that came from a mom. She desperately sent this to her son in an attempt to get some help in understanding the abbreviations that she sometimes received in text messages. And she innocently asks her teen, what does IDK, LY, and TTYL mean? And her son responds back and says, I don't know, love you, talk to you later. And the oblivious mom says, okay, I'll ask your sister. You kind of feel sorry for her, don't you, right? Some of you are going to have to explain that to the person beside you, what just took place. One of my favorite biblical examples of intentional discipleship is of the New Testament, of Timothy's family tree. And Paul writes to Timothy, and he says in 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 5, he says, I am reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother, Lois, and in your mother, Eunice, and I am persuaded now lives in you also. Did you hear how he describes the faith of the mother and the grandmother? It's a sincere faith. There's a legacy there. Look, moms, you're going to make mistakes, but I would challenge you that when you make mistakes, that you let that sincere faith show. Don't try to pretend. Don't try to fake it for your kids. Your kids can sniff out a double standard in a heartbeat. If you just play at church and that's all you do and it's not a real relationship with the Lord, they will pick up on that. And when you make a mistake, you be honest about that and you talk to your kids about it and you go to them, whether they're 6 or they're 26, and you say, hey, I'm sorry, I blew it. I sinned. I made a mistake and here's what I did and I hope you'll forgive me and I won't do it again. Let them see your sincerity. Let them sense your authenticity. And that way, when they screw up, they will be much more apt to come clean and to ask for forgiveness. You see, Satan wants you to think that really all you need to do is just bring your kids to church on the weekend and they'll grow up and they'll have a strong faith. Not in this world. The truth is they need to see you model that faith in the home, day in and day out. So everything that we're doing, we are pouring into them so that someday when they leave home and enter adulthood, they are spiritually prepared and ready, and their faith has become their own. It's become personal. Someone put it like this. They said, if the father is the head of the household, then the mom is the heart of the household. The father is the head of the household, then the mom is the heart of the household. I know it's easy as a parent to say, oh, well, I've still got time. I've got plenty of time. I've got another 12 years or some of the ones that were dedicated today. I've got another 17 or 18 years. But don't put it off. I'm telling you, it goes so quickly. As a man who has 3 grown children, it goes so quickly. The days are long, but the years are short. And I think what we see in the life of Jochebed is this sense of urgency. She knows from the time Moses is born that she's living on borrowed time. And so from the very beginning, she is very intentional. That's what we need to be. We need to be just as intentional. I want you to listen to some words from Deuteronomy chapter 6. You probably are familiar with these words, but let me just read them to you as a refresher. Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 5 through 9. You just listen to these. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts. Impress them on your children. Talk about them when you sit at home and when you walk along the road and when you lie down and when you get up. Tie them as symbols on your hands and bind them on your foreheads. Write them on the door frames of your houses and on your gates. Now, do you know who wrote the words here in Deuteronomy? Who gave that challenge to parents? It's Moses. Moses wrote these words, and I think that it came out of his upbringing. It came through the fact that he had seen the importance of impressing God's word upon sons and daughters. I think it's because he had an example of what that looked like growing up. And I'm so thankful on this Mother's Day for a mom who modeled this well, and for mothers in this church who model it well. And you can see it in the way they interact with their kids. You can see it in their adult kids and in their grandchildren. My mom, when she was alive, she gave our family some of the most thoughtful gifts you could ever imagine. She always put some time and some thought into a gift that she would give. But I also would tell you that my mom also gave some of the strangest gifts that you could ever imagine. And maybe some of you can relate to that. And she worried constantly about her kids kind of was nervous on how things would go with us. For instance, years ago, she saw a commercial about a product that was, it was an orange hammer. And this guy was in a car, and somehow his car took a wrong turn, and he ended up driving into a lake. Doesn't make a lot of sense, I know, but as his car is being submerged and sinking down into the water, he tries his power windows, but they won't work. He tries to push his door open, but the force of the water is too heavy. So what does he do while he's going underwater? He nonchalantly reaches in his glove compartment, and what does he do? He pulls out an orange hammer that looks just like this, and it's got a metal tip on it, and he goes bing, bing, bing on the side window. It shatters, and then he swims out to safety like everything's fine. And my mom saw that commercial, and she thought, oh, no. What if my kids turn into a lake and they can't get out of the car? And so that Christmas, every single one of her kids, every single one of the spouses, every single grandchild who was 16 or older received one of these. She gave it to me. I said, Mom, that thing will poke my eye out. She said, oh, no, I want you to be safe. If you ever go in, and I'm telling you what, we were brutal for the next few years. Every family reunion that we would have, whenever we'd be getting ready to leave, my brother or I, one of us would start it off, and as we were all heading out to the cars, one of us would say, now, will any of you all be traveling over a road that's near a body of water? Okay? And then the other one would immediately jump in and say, does everybody have their orange hammer in close proximity? Okay? And my mom would just say, you boys are terrible, and walk off, you know? And that happened time and time again. But I'm thankful that my mom was worried about our physical safety, but more importantly, I'm grateful that she was more concerned about pouring into us for the sake of all eternity. And in our early years, she purposely taught Bible stories to us. She deliberately pointed out the power of prayer, that's where we ran to. She put scriptures throughout the house. She was intentional. You know, in our world today, busyness seems to be the hallmark. Everybody is busy, and we have to be very deliberate because of it, and we also have to be very careful. A family in chaos with everybody running off to do their own thing creates instability and insecurity in a child's heart. And that heart can't be filled if we're moving in so many different directions and if you're running on empty. So don't buy into the current cultural climate that tends to say, hey, you've got to be involved in countless activities. You have to be on the move all the time. Instead, moms, you are to be a calming presence. You protect your family time with the intensity and the tenacity of a Doberman. Well, here's the third quality that matters. And that is being a faithful follower. A faithful follower of Jesus Christ. That people know exactly where you stand on issues of faith. That they know that your faith is real. If you take a look at Jochebed's family, you begin to see how this legacy comes together. Don't miss this. I have not really thought about it until I was working on this. You have Aaron, one of Jochebed's sons. He is the high priest. You have Miriam, who is this worship leader. They come across the Red Sea. They walk through the Red Sea on dry land. They get to the other side. Who is it that leads them in worship? It's not Moses. It's not Aaron. It's their sister. Miriam is part of vertical back then in Israel, right? and she leads them in a worship time. And then there's Moses, who leads this exodus of approximately 2 million Israelites out of captivity. I mean, this is incredible. These three are like a leadership dynasty, but this legacy was started by a bold, godly mom who took a step of faith. And in Hebrews chapter 11, it's called the faith chapter, or the hall of faith, hall of fame of faith, where all these great heroes are commended for their example that they set for us in being faithful followers of God's will. And right here in that list, we find a mention of Moses' parents. And so what I'm saying today, moms, to each of you, is creatively and lovingly and winsomely raise your kids to know the Lord. You can be a hero in God's hall of fame. Simply put, a mother's legacy is defined by her children. But Jochebed's children became more because of the fact that she loved God more than she loved them. She was more committed to loving the Lord than she was to loving her own flesh and blood. And as I've been talking, I know what some of you are thinking. I just know it. At every campus, there are ones of you who are listening to this, and you've got a sinking feeling in your heart, and you want to say to me, Dave, I've tried my best. I've tried to be a positive encourager, an intentional discipler, a faithful follower of Christ, yet still my child or my children have walked away from the Lord. And the truth is that as a mom, as a father, you can do everything the right way, and your child can still break your heart. And you know who knows what that feels like, because he's done everything perfectly. Your heavenly Father has done everything perfectly. And yet still, we as his children choose the wrong direction at times. And so what we need is what the Bible calls a peace that passes understanding. What we need is God's amazing grace. We need God's redeeming power within our home. And if you study through the scriptures, you'll find that there's not one example anywhere in all the Bible of a perfect family. Not one. In fact, the Bible seems to go out of its way to reveal some really wacko families and the problems that these scriptural families had. Now, why does the Bible go to lengths to show us all that? Well, because it's real. Because it's true. And so that's real life. All of us, every one of us, are a part of families that are broken, in need of God's redemption and grace and power. We need him to put the broken pieces back together. So on this day, we put our hope not in our own efforts, but we put our hope in God's grace and his mercy. And we say, Lord, I need you. I need you in my life. I need you when it comes to my parenting or my grandparenting. I need you in my interaction with my family. I need you all the way around the horn. And many of you I know are single parents, and you're trying to overcome the conflict and the tension that used to be present in that rough relationship that you were a part of. And now you found that after the divorce that there is still conflict and frustration. It's just in a different form. And maybe it's over the custody. Or maybe it's over the fact that your ex is with someone else now and they don't parent the way that you want your kids parented. Or maybe you're exhausted because it's tough to be a parent when you're flying solo. Well, first I would say to each and every one of you, my heart goes out to you. My heart goes out to you. But secondly, I would tell you, if you honor the Lord and you invite him into your family, God can do some really amazing things. In every row, in every campus, has story after story of how God showed up in some spectacular way and something happened in a family that you weren't expecting, and God worked good out of evil. You know, in Psalm 146, verse 9, it says this: the Lord watches over the foreigner and sustains the fatherless and the widow. If you're a single parent, I hope you'll just grasp a hold of that. The Lord watches over and sustains the fatherless. God says, I will be a father to the fatherless. Do you realize the implications of such a promise? To the single parent, whether it's a man or a woman. God says you can't do both roles in and of yourself. But the Lord raises his hand and volunteers and says, I'll help. You want some help? I'll make up the difference. And so regardless of your particular situation, I want you to realize how it is that God can work in your life. Think of it like this. Your greatest contribution to the kingdom of God may not be something you do, but someone you raise. Why you're here on this earth might be the way that you pour into a child, into a grandchild, and how it is that God uses them. He's going to use you to prepare the way. If you believe that, then it will revolutionize the way you strive to leave a legacy of faith to your family. Hey, we've all made mistakes, and we wish we had some do-overs, but we can learn from our past. We don't have to live in our past. We just have to humbly say, Lord, I need you. Will you walk alongside of me? My mom's favorite verse, 3 John, verse 4, says this, I have no greater joy than to know that my children are walking in the truth. And moms, they will be much more likely to take that path if your journey is Spirit-led and God-governed, if he's the one who calls the shots in your life. Doesn't mean that you're not going to make mistakes. Of course you will. We all will. Doesn't mean that sometimes unintentionally you might get off the path and have to apologize to your kids for a wrong choice you made. Of course we will. But our God is big enough. Because when it comes to your parenting, God is much more concerned with your direction than he is your perfection. He wants to know which direction it is that you're moving and where it is that you're taking your family. He specializes in rebuilding, restoring, and redeeming. So moms, let him do that in your life. And let him do it in your family. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we've not always done things your way, but would you help us in those moments to turn our hearts toward you, to put trust in your word and to put trust in your truth and to ask you for help and not to try to go it alone. And Lord, would you fill the moms in this room and on every campus with your spirit and give them your strength and your joy and your peace. Because on their own, they realize that they're going to need your help. So would you help them to learn to cry out to you? And would you work in powerful ways within the families of this church and the moms who are here? It's in the name of Jesus that we pray. Amen.